Hare Krishna. Wonderful to be back here. So all of you at the lotus feet of their lordships. And over the next few days, I'll speak on this very profound and sometimes puzzling section in the Bhagavatam. This is the prayers by the child in the womb of the mother. So I've titled this as Understanding the Unborn's Understandings. The soul is unborn right now. What are the understandings and how does the soul get that understanding? So we'll discuss that and what it means, what the soul prays, what the soul understands. Inside the womb, what does it mean for us as we live life outside the womb and go through the various upheavals of life? So in today, in this particular verse, the second verse, the previous verse says that the soul says, I surrender to the Lord, I take shelter of Him. And then in this verse, the soul is actually expressing awareness of the position of the Lord. That although this Lord whom I'm praying to, He's right next to me, He's with me. But Vishuddham Avikaram Akhandabodham, He is pure, He is unaffected. His knowledge is not covered. So he's recognizing his transcendental position. And normally when we seek help from someone, one of the first things we want to know is, what is the credential of this person to offer me help? Does this person actually have the competence? So if somebody is giving us financial advice, and if they are themselves maybe living on the streets, then we would be thinking, should I be taking financial advice from such a person? The soul wants to be enlightened. Soul wants to be released. And the soul is acknowledging that the Lord Himself is always enlightened, always free, always liberated. Not only liberated, the Lord is also the liberator. And here it is said, Ataapyamana Hridaya Vasitam. Ataapyamana is repentant. In the repentant heart, the Lord becomes manifest. So before this, the oral section here, which is going on in the third canto, is Kapiladev is doing an analysis of the nature of material nature so that we can be inspired, impelled, driven to take shelter of the Lord by practicing Bhakti Yoga. Now that analysis is done in various ways. So basically, the world holds a lot of appeal. In fact, the world can be irresistibly appealing. And to some extent, as long as we are captivated by the world, we cannot stay connected with the Lord. Because the world will pull us. So to some extent, how do we become free from the captivation of the world? It is through analysis. So he does different forms of analysis. One form of analysis he does is, which is in the previous chapters, 28, 29, that divide material elements, the material world, into its component elements. And then, say, if there is some very attractive, even seductive picture somewhere, we might get captivated by it. But we might get attracted to it. But if, if somebody deconstructed the picture and showed, okay, this is just, maybe a set of colors. Now, if somebody has put some white color, some brown color, some yellow color, some black color, and all of them combined together, if they are put on the ground at various places, we are not going to get captivated by that. So deconstructing a thing into its components is one way of dissipating its lure. So similarly, what he does is that, okay, this material world looks so attractive, that sense objects are so captivating. But understand that they are just nothing but the material elements. Everything is just earth, water, fire, air, ether combined together. Now in the kitchen, all the ingredients which we use for cooking are there. Now, when people sometimes they are attracted to some food. Now, they are not attracted to the ingredients per se. They are attracted to the finished product. So, if we just understand this is just made of these ingredients, that can create some detachment. Ataha kavibhir namasu yavadartha. That everything that is attractive is simply a name. But essentially, it's just a combination of the same material elements. So that's one way of decreasing the lure of material nature. Now here, another way of decreasing the lure of material nature is by describing the life journey of a typical soul. So the Bhagavatam will describe how a person who lives in materialistic life, how they suffer from so many different ways, from even family members, friends, the government, the other living beings, from their own body, mind. And this suffering is what also brings detachment. So one aspect of that suffering is suffering in the womb. So the idea is that suffering begins even before we could say our life begins. Many times when somebody has a birthday, I hope nobody has a birthday today. I don't want to offend anyone. But so normally when we say happy birthday to someone, we often mean well and we have genuine good wishes. But we were not happy on our birthday. When we were born, we were crying. And it's painful. And actually even in the womb, it was painful. That's being revealed over here. So to exist is to suffer. That is one of the most fundamental truths of life. And as long as we don't recognize it, we'll never seek a higher existence. So the previous verses have described the suffering of the child in the womb. I was in Kannada a few months ago and I was at a person's place. He was a new upcoming devotee. He had a construction company. And the construction company's byline or slogan was, our houses are as comfortable as your mother's womb. Now, he had probably not heard about the third canto of Bhagavatam. But when I inquired a little bit about this, it seems that from a biological perspective, the womb is designed to be a very safe place that is as comfortable as possible for the embryo. So if there are some incidental shocks, there is amniotic fluid, and there are other arrangements by which the shocks are there, like there are shock absorber mechanisms. So if we consider that what is inside the womb is like a bag, then that bag is kept comfortably. It's like if we put in some luggage if we in the back side of our the trunk of our car, we put in luggage. Sometimes the luggage has to be squeezed in and pushed in all directions. But sometimes the luggage fits in. It's a tight bag, but it fits in well. So, and the hood of the trunk is designed in such a way that the luggage stays safe. So like that, we could say from a biological perspective, the womb is designed to be, nature designs everything in such a way that it maximizes the possibility of survival. So therefore, the womb is also designed in a way that will facilitate survival. But the problem in all this reasoning is that the embryo in the womb is not just a biological bag. It's a conscious being. And we think if we were stuffed in the hood of a car, even if we are not squeezed and cramped completely, still, it would be extremely uncomfortable. It's dark. It's scary. And we don't even know where we are going. There's no one to talk to, no one to understand who is, no one to get any sense of orientation of what is happening. And as the womb starts growing more, as the embryo starts growing more and more, then the cramping also comes in and becomes extremely painful. So as the child in the womb, as now consciousness starts manifesting as the child keeps growing. And these prayers, the Bhagavatam says, are spoken in the seventh month of the pregnancy. That means at that time the consciousness is developed enough and the child starts feeling pain, immense pain. And at that pain, desperately, the soul calls out for the Lord. And these are the prayers which are offered at that time. So this is the background in which these prayers are offered, that it's overall describing how distressful material existence is, and therefore we need to detach ourselves from material existence and attach ourselves to the Lord. So we'll discuss different themes. Today I will discuss this theme of, okay, how, from a, if we consider from a growth perspective, from a normal growth trajectory, we are having difficulty reciting these verses. And what, how can a child in the womb recite verses like this? Does it even have the cognitive capacity to recite verses? If we consider that the brain has to be sufficiently developed to do certain things, then how does the child do those things like this? And how does the child even know about God? So this is where we need to go beyond biology. That is, the soul is on a multi-life journey of spiritual evolution. And during this multi-life journey, the soul's consciousness is manifest according to the level of the body. But the soul's consciousness is not limited to the body. Just to give an example of the difference between what is manifested and what it is capable of. Sometimes, some people might get some brain damage and then they go into coma. And when they are in coma, often the doctors, caregivers tell that, keep speaking to them. Even if their eyes are closed, even if they don't seem to be at all responding, we don't even know whether they are hearing, just keep speaking, expressing your love for them, expressing your appreciation for them, encouraging them. And sometimes it takes weeks for the person to come out of the coma, and then sometimes they remember, oh, you spoke like this. This person spoke like that. That person spoke like that. So, and sometimes their eyes are open and they can see, but they can't respond. They just don't have the capacity to respond. So basically, they are conscious, but they are not able to manifest their consciousness. Normally, when we feel happy, we smile. Normally, when we feel angry, we frown, glare. But that's because we have at present control over our body, at least to the extent by which the body can be a tool for the expression of our emotions. But if the body, in the case of coma, the physical body may not be damaged, but the link between the brain and the body is weakened. And because of which, the soul cannot manifest its consciousness. Now that doesn't mean the soul doesn't have the capacity for consciousness. The capacity is there, just the manifestation is not there. This is, of course, we are talking about within one lifetime. Say the person had normal behavioral capacities, and then they had some trauma or some accident, and that behavioral capacity went down to this level. So from here, it crashed down to this level. And then gradually it may rise up and they may regain their cognitive faculties. And they start functioning normally afterward. This is what happens within a life. So for most of us, if we don't go through any such incident, then our consciousness is more or less like this. It just keeps going on at more or less one level. More or less at one level. Now what happens between one life and next life? When the soul leaves the body, and then the soul is going to go to a next body. In between, the Garuda Purana explains that the soul, we have two bodies. Subtle body, the soul is here, the subtle body is here, the gross body is here. So now, at death, the gross body is left behind. And the soul with the subtle body goes to the next body. Just like say, if we have a computer and the computer is damaged, then we go to a new computer. And when we go to a new computer, at that time, we go there and we take the information about, say, our login details. If you have a Google account, Gmail account, then we take the information about our login details and then we enter that into that next computer. And then immediately, all our preferences, all our history, all our past choices, they get linked to that computer. So similarly, when the soul goes from one body to another body, the body is like the physical computer. It is damaged and it's over. But the the soul, when it goes, now in our case, we may just carry in our memory that particular information. In the case of the soul goes with the mind. And in the mind, all the impressions are stored. And then the soul with that mind links with the next body. And that's how, even if two children are born simultaneously, even if they are twins, even if they are identical twins, still they are not behaviorally identical. They may be genetically identical, they may be physically identical, but with respect to behavior, with respect to personality, they are distinct. Because each soul is different. The physical apparatus, the physical tool that they have is identical, but they as conscious beings with their own minds are different. So now in this case, we are talking about if the soul is in this one body and it's come out of the body, it's going to the next body. Now the journey, we will not, it's also itself a big subject. What happens to the soul between one life and another life before it gets the next body? The Garuda Puran describes that the soul gets another body which is grosser than the subtle body and subtler than the gross body, which is like a transition form. And in that body, the soul goes to the next body. So then the soul is always, when the soul is in that in-between state, is always looking for some suitable biological medium in which it can manifest itself. Because the soul needs a tool to function. It's like if somebody is, their whole work is on computer and they don't have a computer, and they're looking, where can I get a computer? And I can use that computer. And sometimes somebody is desperate for a computer. Somebody else might be working on a computer. They just come and push that person away and start working on their computer. That is what happens when there is possession by ghosts. When a person is possessed by a ghost, that means what happens? A soul enters into their body and takes control of their body. And there are documented cases of people. There was a Maharashtrian woman. Maharashtra is a state in India. And she suddenly started speaking Bengali. Bengal is completely another part of the country. And she had never been out of her district also, what to speak of her out of her state. And she had no Bengali neighbors. And she started speaking in a different voice. So, not just her normal voice. And then a well-documented case, Dutta Karma Prabhu, in his book Human Devolution, he gives many such cases. And there are many people who have done the study of the supernatural. The eerie, the encounter with the eerie. Let me just complete them. You have a question? Two souls in one body. One soul becomes dormant, the other soul becomes dominant. So, yeah. Well, no, the Paramatma is there with each soul always. So then you could say there are two Paramatma. Well, each soul has the Paramatma. Yeah? No, that's not the ghost body. That's the ghost. Ghost is basically the this is like a transition. See, just like say we might wear some normal clothes, but if we are driving out, we might put on some clothes just for driving, and then we come back and we take out the clothes, take out that overalls, whatever we are wearing. So this is like a transition body. But a ghost is not exactly in a stage of transition. A ghost is in a state of, you could say, eviction. The ghost has destroyed, the soul is a ghost has destroyed one's own body. And then the soul is not going to get any other body immediately. So that's not, a ghost is simply disembodied. Disembodied means it's the body and the mind. That's all. The soul and the mind, not the body. The soul and the mind. The spiritual and the subtle body, that's all. Okay, so now it's the soul comes to the next body, enters into the body, and then starts functioning according to the body. Shrotram chakshusparshanam cha rasanam granamevacham adishthayam anishchayam vishayan upasevate. In the 15th chapter of the Bhagavad-Gita, in texts 8 and 9, Krishna talks about 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, he is talking about the transmigration of the soul. And there he says, the soul acquires a particular set of senses. Ears, eyes, nose, tongue, skin, and through that the soul starts functioning in the world seeking sense objects for pleasure. Now that is once the soul, you could say the body grows up enough for the soul to do that. But before that, so what we are discussing right now, what is happening in the womb. So the soul has a normal physical body in a previous life, then it goes through the transition, then it has come into the womb, and now it is acquiring a body. And when the soul is acquired, as the body is not growing, in general, our consciousness manifests according to the level of our body. Both, whether it is with respect to material things or with respect to spiritual things. That means, sometimes we say children are innocent. Now, yes, in one sense it's true. Children are innocent. They haven't done anything wrong or anything inappropriate in this life. They might be mischievous, but that's just childish. But even a child, the soul is carrying the mind, and impressions such as lust are there in that soul also. However, because the body is not adequately developed, so therefore, those particular feelings, that particular attraction doesn't come up till puberty comes in. So that means the soul and the mind, usually they need the appropriate body to express whatever is within them. The body is either damaged, or the body is absent, or the body is underdeveloped. Then the soul's consciousness and the mind's desires, they will not get expressed. There's no channel for expressing them. Now, normally speaking, for a person to function reasonably at the material level, the soul, the mind, and the body need to be reasonably integrated together. If the soul, mind, and body are not well integrated, it can lead to a lot of problems. Say, for example, some people have what is called a gender dysphoria. That means they may be in a male body, but they think, I'm a female. They identify themselves as a female. Or conversely, a female may identify as a male. Now, this could of course be sociological and other things, but from one perspective, what has happened is, the soul, just like say, if I fly from India to America, then when I fly, the body naturally is not used to moving so fast. And although physically I have come to America, but my body's clock is still functioning according to India. That's what we call as jet lag. And some people recover from jet lag quickly, maybe just a day or two. Some people may take a week or so to recover from jet lag. So similarly, when the soul leaves one body and enters into another body, we could say there is a transmigration lag that happens. And this transmigration lag can manifest in different ways. Now, especially if the death was sudden and violent, then the soul does not get the time to process the event of death. And I have written a book on reincarnation where I talk about past life, children who remember their past life, an amazing story with very persuasive evidence. The children not only have recollections, I was this person living over here and I did this, but they have recognitions. When they go there, they recognize those people and they have behaviors. No, with a lady, a man who claims, a boy who claims, okay, I was a wife, I was a husband of this person in the previous life. That boy is 5 years old and that lady is now 35. And this boy treats that lady as if she is his wife. 5 years old. And he has got children from a previous life who are like 7, 8 years old and he's still fondling his hair like that. As if he were their father. His behavior, and then there are birthmarks also and birth defects corresponding to the fatal wounds that they sustained in the previous life. So in this case, now why do some children only remember their past lives and others don't? There could be many reasons, but one reason is that the soul is not able to process the event of death. It happened so suddenly, and that's why there is a transmigration lag. And because of this transmigration lag, just like we have a jet lag, that means the body is in India, body's clock is functioning according to India. So like that, this child has now got a physical body in this life, but its memory is still over there. And usually, the children, as they grow up, they go and meet their family from the previous life, spend some time with them. And eventually, they have what is called emotional closure. And if those children grow up, maybe 15, 20, after I wrote this book on reincarnation, I again did some research that how many of these children who remembered their past lives actually became spiritual because of those memories. It's practically none of them. As they grow older, what they just remember it. Yes, you know, I used to remember my past life. They might also remember it, but the emotional intensity is gone. It's just something I remember from my childhood. Yeah, this also is one thing I remember. It's unusual, but that's all it is. So basically, when the soul remembers a previous life, that is because there is no emotional closure. So similarly, the soul may not be able to, when somebody feels a sense of misidentification with their body. That means it may be that somebody is a male and they feel as if they are a female. Now that could just be because of social propaganda also, but if it is a deep incompatibility, that is often because the soul is having a lag and the soul is identifying with the body from a previous life. So to be detached from the body is good, but to be disintegrated from the body is bad. Now, to be disintegrated from the body, how do you function with the two? The body is a car, and if I always feel while I'm in the car, I'm in the wrong place, I'm in the wrong car. Well, then you can't drive that car properly. So we need to be reasonably integrated with our body so that we can function with the body. We don't want to be so integrated that we identify with the body entirely, thinking I am the body. So the point I was making is, I'm making two distinct points. In general, the soul's consciousness manifests through the body. And if the bodily apparatus is not there, the soul's consciousness does not manifest. But I gave some exceptions as examples to illustrate how the soul's consciousness is manifest independent of the body. Some children remember their past lives, and some people have this gender dysphoria. So why am I giving these examples? I was answering the question, how can a child whose brain is not developed, is just a soul in the embryo in the womb, how can that soul even have the cognitive faculties to compose and offer prayers like this to God? So here the point is, in extreme situations, in normal situations, the soul, mind and body function together as one unit. But in extreme situations, the soul and mind may become disconnected, disjointed from the body. This sometimes happens in extreme cases in out-of-body, near-death experiences and out-of-body experiences. But sometimes the person is neurologically unconscious. And yet they see themselves as if they are floating from above. And they describe everything that happened. This doctor did this, and this nurse said this, and this did that. And they describe it in vivid detail. And there's just no way they could have done it physically, because the brain waves are flat. Nothing is happening in the brain. So sometimes the soul and the mind can perceive without the body. Sometimes that may require physical separation from the body. Sometimes it may not require physical separation from the body. So when the child is offering all these prayers, now we needn't have a simplistic understanding that is, the child in the womb is actually seeing the Lord next to him and then offering prayers. It can happen like that if they want. But the whole idea is that this can happen through non-physical means. The physical body, just like the child after being born, it takes a good amount of time, at least a year or so, before the child can start articulating any words. So what to speak of elaborate Sanskrit verses like this. So what is happening? This is happening through non-physical means. So when there is immense pain at the physical level, the soul, in order to bear that pain, soul has to distance itself from the body. Just like we sometimes, when we are in extreme pain, either physical or emotional, we faint. Because we have an innate pain avoidance mechanism. And when the pain becomes unbearable, being conscious would be excruciating. So our consciousness switches off. And that's how we withstand that pain. So in this case, what has happened? The soul is offering prayers through the, at the physical level, there is extreme pain, and that extreme situation has caused a distancing between the soul and the body. The soul and the mind is on one side, the body is on the other side. So the soul is offering these prayers through non-physical means. Non-physical means it's not that the soul is verbally articulating these prayers. So the soul doesn't necessarily need the brain capacity to be developed to process all this. That brain development will happen gradually. So the brain is like a tool. But even if the brain is not there, say we imagine maybe 100 years down the line, everybody is just dependent only on calculators. And even to do, 10 plus 5 is how much, let me look at my calculator. And then the basic arithmetic also they do through calculators. And somebody's calculator gets damaged. And they say, I can't, now if I have become so dependent on my device, then I won't be able to calculate anything. And if somebody else calculates it as age 15, your calculator is also not working. How do you do that? Well, you don't need a calculator to do that. So, the capacity to basic arithmetic is there, but it can be dumbed down by dependence on devices. So, similarly, for the soul to come into a body is actually the dumbing down of the consciousness. We may feel the soul needs the body for functioning, and that is true. For functioning at the physical level, the soul needs the body. Right now we have body, and if our body falls sick, we can't do anything practically. But that's at the functional level, when in the embodied state, at a physical functional level. But for the soul's consciousness is capable of perceiving much bigger realities. And when the soul comes into a body, its consciousness gets restricted to the body. So it's like a dumbing down of consciousness. So the soul is offering these prayers without needing the bodily resources, because the soul has these impressions in the mind. And where do those impressions in the mind come from? They come from a previous life. As I said, we all are all on a multi-life journey of spiritual evolution. And in this multi-life journey, we all have certain knowledge which is unmanifest presently, which will gradually become accessible. So that idea of unmanifest spiritual knowledge becoming accessible at a particular point, we'll discuss in tomorrow's class. I'll summarize today what I spoke. I spoke on this theme of understanding the unborn's understandings. We'll look at the prayers of the child in the womb. And the child is praying that, my dear Lord, I surrender to you. Although I am suffering and you are with me, but you are transcendental. I take shelter of you. And you can be pursued by the repentant heart. In the repentant heart. So, I discussed broadly three main themes. I talked about what is the section doing, what is going on in this section of the Bhagavatam. Kapildev is detaching, is helping us to become detached from the world so that we can become attached to the Lord. By deconstructing the world. One way he does it by, earlier he has done the previous chapters, is by showing everything attractive is nothing but just a combination of the material elements. A beautiful picture is not just nothing but a few colors. All material things are just earth, water, fire, and ether. And then he is analyzing our average life journey and showing how it is filled with so much misery. That misery begins right from the womb. And then I discussed about the womb might be biologically comfortable. Because a home developer says our houses are as comfortable as the mother's womb. But that's not considering the consciousness of the child. It's like if we are put in a trunk, even if we are not in a trunk Even if you're not squeezed, still it's dark and scary and disorienting. So like that, the child is squeezed over there. And it is painful at that place. And then the main part of the class was, we tried to address the question, how can a child whose brain is not developed enough to articulate even a few words after the child is born, how can that child compose and recite such extraordinary verses? So then in that section, I talked about how the soul, the mind and the body, they are normally linked together, and normally the soul requires the body to function. Normally, say a person doesn't feel lusty till they attain puberty. But in extreme situations, the distance between the body and the soul can be increased. And I gave two examples, as children who remember past lives and people who may have gender dysphoria. That's because what has happened is, just like a person traveling across many time zones has jet lag, some souls who maybe have a violent death and are not able to process the event of death, they have a transmigration lag, because of which the mind stays in the previous life. And so that can happen conceivably. And I talk about even in the course of life, near-death experiences are there, when the soul distances itself from the body, when the body is undergoing trauma. And the soul is conscious, although the brain is unconscious. So in that case, the conscious awareness is through non-physical means. And similarly, the child over here is offering these prayers through non-physical means. That is, the soul and the mind, the impressions stored in it, based on that, this is being uttered. And now, how does the soul have the impressions which can enable it to offer prayers about God? That is from a previous life. And how the knowledge, the spiritual knowledge of a previous life can be manifest in this life, I'll discuss in tomorrow's session. So any questions or comments? Yes, Shyam.
I think there's more than that. Some reason I hear.
Happy to hear.
Just some appreciations of the picking out some prayer boxes. I really like the analogy you gave that just like reliance on calculators degrades one from the natural intelligence of doing mathematics. Mm-hmm. I'm not going to do a teacher who never let us use calculators because we didn't do this. But similarly, the conditioned reliance or the identification with the gross and subtle body actually degrades the soul as natural. But those were fantastic analogy. I did have several things I appreciate, but just for the sake of time. I did have one question. It's kind of a classic question, so I'm sure you've heard it before. Most likely. Prabhupada indicates, maybe it was his purport, or another one, that the fortunate soul in such a position can pray to the Lord. But he doesn't directly indicate it's whether all souls are fortunate in that sense, or whether some souls in that context of being damaged from their, as you pointed out, traumatic material experience and access their spiritual realization of I've been here before, I'm actually a servant of God, and they can do that. So is it indicated anywhere in any commentaries, or is it any realization that what does that mean? The fortunate soul, only some souls in neutral lives at all, and they forget.
Yeah, it's a good question. When Prabhupada says fortunate soul remembers and prays like this, so does that mean that are all souls fortunate or is it only some souls? Yeah, I have also not read anything decisive about this, but I can make some inferences. Sure. So the broad thing is that although from our visible perspective, life in the womb or life in the disembodied state, while going from one body to another, that can seem dramatically different from our normal embodied state. So, because this is what we are familiar with. But overall, all these states, the state in the womb, the state in the maybe a transition body or a ghost situation, or in a normal physical embodied situation, for all of these, the soul is on a journey of evolution. And just as when we, in our embodied state, have distress, it's not that everyone turns to God and prays at that time. In 7:16 in the Bhagavad-Gita, Krishna says, Chaturvidha bhajante mam jana sukrutino arjuna arto chikya surarthaarthi jnani cha bharatarshava. That there are four kinds of people who turn to me. But he uses the specific word sukrutinaha. When they are in distress or need, they turn to me. What makes them turn to me? It is because they are Sukrutina. It is because they are, they have some spiritual pious credits. Otherwise, when people are distressed, they may take drugs, they may just go into indiscriminate net drug surfing, they might become suicidal. So just as not everybody in distress turns toward God in the embodied stage outside the womb. So similarly, not everybody, not every child in the womb will necessarily turn toward God. So just as some souls are fortunate, now what makes them fortunate? You could say in the embodied state, it could be that they have got some culture which makes them pray toward God. They've got some association which inspires them. Or they have something from their previous life which inspires them. So similarly, so that means the what prompts us toward God, even in our embodied state, it is either something internal or something external from a impression from a previous life or the upbringing of this life, or external in terms of the association here. So we could say the same dynamic applies in the womb also. If that soul in a previous life has practiced some bhakti, has done something spiritual, those impressions are there, and those impressions may prompt the soul to turn toward God. Or if that soul is being born in a devotee family, then maybe the influence of the parents might prompt that turning toward God. But when Prabhupada says it's fortunate, it means that it's not necessary that it's going to happen to every soul. It can, but it's just that the soul has free will outside the womb. It's not that the soul's free will is taken away inside the womb. So not all souls may turn toward God because they may not use their free will that way. Okay. Yes, please.
Thank you. I was thinking about one was about the homeless situation which I experienced yesterday just in driving. I want to talk about that, but maybe we can talk about that at another time. The other was regarding somebody who's had an accident and has severe brain damage. And my son's friend has had that situation. And as you were speaking, I was thinking about, you know, what happens in, he's sort of stuck in the body. He can't speak, and his brain has been damaged, but, and so is he, it's, you know, I think of him as hopefully with prayer and compassion getting to the next spiritual level, you know, maybe in that state he's asking for strength to come to a new spiritual consciousness. I don't know if that's possible, you know what I mean? You spoke a little bit about that. So it's this time in which you're in between. And, you know, we pray, we see, you know, in this material world, we want them to come back to normal. I don't know if that'll ever happen. But we can pray that he'll maybe come to a new place in his spiritual growth.
Yeah. In that body. It's true. If we know somebody is in a comatose state, then what can we do for them, basically? Yeah. See, that is a stage of almost being in like no man's land. The soul is not in this body in the normal way. The soul is not leaving that body also. So broadly speaking, you can certainly try if there is a reasonable hope for medical recovery. And if we give them as much spiritual vibrations as possible, there is, I'll talk later about conscious choice and unconscious reception. Now, even if spiritual vibrations are received unconsciously, without somebody choosing, still there will be. The benefit is much more when it's consciously chosen. But if it is not going to be seen as sectarian, and if we can, that can, if soothing music is there, that can give them some solace at that level also and raise their consciousness to God. Well, nowadays, these cases often become a lot more because we have a lot of life maintenance systems that we can have artificial support system for maintaining life, even if normally in that state the life would not be maintained. So when Prabhupada was asked about this, Prabhupada said that you know, if there is not much chance of the person surviving, then there is no need to hold on to them. Let that soul go, because the soul is in limbo right now, not being able to do anything. So, but we do know miracles sometimes happen, and people's emotions are deeply invested. So any specific counseling, you have to give very carefully. But definitely, exposure to spiritual sound vibrations at that time is the, apart from our offering prayers for them, also giving them that option to hear. So basically, it's we are here, they are there, and Krishna is here. So when we pray to them, it is like we are approaching Krishna and asking Krishna to connect with them, Krishna to bless them. That is good, definitely. But along with that, if they somehow connect with Krishna, that is, if we bring Krishna into their consciousness, that's also very helpful. Now, when Krishna comes into their conscious awareness, how much do they become conscious of Him? How much they are even capable of becoming conscious of Him? We don't know that. And because Krishna is not like any other physical object. The physical object, say, if my eyes are damaged, if there is a beautiful picture comes before me, I can't see it. Now, we can put a picture of Krishna also. And even if my eyes are damaged, even if I can't physically see Krishna, Krishna is not just a physical object. That's a physical manifestation of Krishna who is a transcendental object. So Krishna, that presence of Krishna on that visual pathway, even if there is no visual perception, is still beneficial. So as much as possible, we try to expose them to spiritual sound vibration or spiritual stimuli in general.
Progress.
Oh, then that's wonderful.
So,
and,
still within them.
Yeah.
So thank you.
Thank you. Yeah. They're making progress, and that's definitely our prayers and whatever we can do to help them. There have been, I know, many cases of people who are completely recovered also. It's not easy, but it's happened. Yes. Do we have time? Let me know. Yeah.
Yeah, we have a question from online.
Okay.
This is from Bhakta Adam in Chicago.
Oh, okay. Hare Krishna, Bhakta Adam.
Yes. While preaching, how can we endeavor to become detached by deconstructing the other? At the same time, connecting with other people who see the world in a constructed manner.
Oh, okay. So while preaching, how can we stay detached by deconstructing, say, the attractiveness of the world? At the same time, we stay connected with people so that we can understand the way they are thinking and become relevant. Yeah, that is the art of, you could say, fishing without getting wet. It's, we want to get what is in the water, but we don't want to get into the water. So we have to have broadly two things. Now, we have our connection with Krishna backwards. We say, if I am here, I have my connection with my roots, with Krishna, with devotees, through sadhana, through studies. So that is what has to be maintained. But at the same time, we also need to extend outward. And in general, if we are going in a particular field, say if I am going to studies, say science and spirituality, and I want to deconstruct atheistic claims of science, then if it's I alone trying to deconstruct what atheists are saying, that's going to be very difficult. Because those atheists may have spent maybe 30, 40 years, that's their life's passion. And I might study atheism for a few days or a few weeks or a few months or at the most a few years. So it's not possible for me just by that much to deconstruct everything that they are saying. So then I need to associate with those who are doing that expertly. So if there are some devotee scientists who have done those studies, then if they can, this is what they are saying. This is what an atheist is saying, but this is how actually it is. Oh, I never thought of that. So for deconstructing, it is very difficult for us to do it ourselves. We need association. Association of those who have studied that aspect of material nature and have been able to see it in spiritual light. To the extent we have that association, to the extent we seek that association, to that extent, we can bring a spiritual vision into it. So we don't want to be detached in the sense of being indifferent or apathetic. We want to be concerned. But for being able to do that, we have to be able to go inside, in terms of go inside our own hearts to connect with Krishna, and go inside to them to connect with them. So generally, it's best that we try to connect with people at a human level first. They may have their culture, they may have their worldview, they may have their lifestyle, but we try to establish a human connection with them. And once we start seeing a human connection with them, then everything else falls in place. Otherwise, we get allured by whatever is being portrayed. So, I'd say broadly, first strong sadhana, second association of people, associating those who have gone to that field, and they have deconstructed that alluring things, the deceptive reality. And lastly, by focusing on human connection rather than a specialized connection at that level. So even an atheist, we need to see first of all as a human being. And then if we're still polite, if we are considerate, then gradually everybody, for most people, their ideology is like a mask. It's like a shield they're holding. So even their it might be ideology, it might be their fashion, it might be their dress, the way they dress, their sexual orientation, all this, whatever it might be. It's all like a shield they are holding in front of them so that they can have some sense of identity and security in the world, which reduces us to insignificance. So then gradually, if they see that we can connect with them at a human level, gradually that shield they will drop, they will lower their guards. And then we can bring Krishna into that more effectively. Okay? So, shall we stop here? So, thank you very much. Grantharaj Srimad Bhagavatam ki, Srila Prabhupada ki, Gaurava Bhaktavinoda ki, Gaur Prema.